everybody. Welcome to the Lifetime Training Podcast. And I'm your host, Jason Stella. And I have a treat for you today. I have the original Jay-Z, our COO, Chief Operating Officer, Mr. Jeff Zweifel today. And I can't thank you enough for spending the time. You are absolutely probably swamped right now with everything that we're dealing with and the success of what we're doing with it. That's one of the reasons why I wanted to have you on. So thank you so much for taking the time, Jeff.
It's a pleasure to be with you, Jason. We go back a lot of years. How many years do you think it's been?
God, well, I started in 2000. And yeah. So, yeah, it's been almost 20 years. And, 20 years then. You know, there's so much we can get into, and we got to stay on topic here. But, you know, I still remember the time, Jeff, honestly, it was probably 2001, about a year and a half in. And you basically said, you know, I really think this is going to be a good position for you. And I wasn't going to take it. I didn't want to take it. And I remember you saying that. And I could honestly say that if it wasn't for you and if it wasn't for that, my career would not be anywhere where it is today. And I can't thank you enough for that.
Well, thank you. You've been a blessing to us as well. And, you know, initiatives like this are at the core of, I think, the identity to Lifetime and who we are and what our culture is attempting to represent. So I appreciate the opportunity to be on here and share some thoughts and ideas.
Awesome. Well, why don't we kick it off? You know, again, one of the biggest things out there is I know, you know, where you came from and your background. Yeah. and going to school for an exercise phys. And I don't think many people really understand this journey that you've had from, you know, college all the way through to where you are today. So I'd love for you to share that story for them.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I'll try to be, you know, as condensed as possible because it, obviously with everyone, it's a long story, but, and it's got its points of inflection, critical like all of us have in our life. But, you know, for me, it started with competitive athletics. And like we were just talking about before we started on the call about our kids now and living vicariously through their athletic endeavors. But, you know, I think finishing grad school, you know, I was really looking to be a strength conditioning coach. I played college football. I went on to coach at the high school and college level, and I couldn't get, you know, sports and athletics out of my system. And couldn't get enough of it. So, you know, I think health and fitness was really just a very natural point to go ahead and move into, given a natural transition of those passions and that energy. And, you know, starting as a trainer for me during the, you know, the Nautilus era, focusing on one set of 8 to 12 reps to exhaustion with the Nautilus equipment. It was, you know, the floor trainer at 7:25 an hour is where I started. And it was a great humbling experience because I, like many of us in the industry, was like a caged animal. I knew I could do more. I knew I could offer more. I knew I could help impact lives better. And I wanted to be able to do that on a larger scale. And so then, you know, after a couple of years, moved into hospital-based fitness management, corporate wellness, corporate health promotion. And obviously, in the late 80s, that was going to take over the world, right? It was every company was going to have a corporate fitness center, and it was all going to be tremendous. But at that time, I made a really difficult decision and moved into a position as an exercise physiologist in, you know, around 1989, 1990, with a company called Nordic Track that was kind of up and coming at the time.
No pictures. I swear. I have no pictures.
Yes. No pictures of that skier.
Yeah.
That infamous position, yeah. The world's best aerobic exerciser. I started that in, you know, 10 years, a decade I was with them and moved in, you know, left there as vice president of product development and ran 360 of the retail locations. And it was, you know, that time, that decade that provided me with really an environment to really combine both my technical knowledge about anatomy and kines and, you know, program design with the business acumen. And I think there's just something, as you and I have always talked about through the years, that in the health and fitness business, there's a tremendous opportunity for somebody that intuitively knows what the consumer is looking for, no matter where they are, whether they're, you know, prenatal, postpartum, overweight, orthopedic, sports and rec, and you kind of intuitively, based on our unique backgrounds, know what their journey should look like. Mm-hmm. And to combine that then with marketing and sales and, you know, financial acumen, and then, you know, in 1998, I came to Lifetime. So it's been 22 years for me here, and a really diverse background through my 22 years almost at Lifetime, from coming in and creating a new division. I came in as, created my own title as Vice President of New Business Ventures in the early days of Lifetime, as you know, through Brahm. We didn't have a formal HR department. So basically created a division with the Health Enhancement Division, as you remember. And we started educational products. We developed our own nutritional products and did all the research on all our multivitamins and EFAs. And,
I don't think many people understood and knew that is the fact that you were the one that brought that in and brought nutrition and supplementation and all of that into Lifetime, because we didn't have it.
Yeah. And, you know, we knew that the trainers understanding that product would be the most important medium for us. We brought that product at that time, if you remember, Jason, to 15,000 mass market retail doors. Yep. And then before the company went public in 2005, Brahm and I had a really great conversation, and it was in another inflection point for me in my career that I was talking about earlier. And, you know, he said, a lot of things you can do with the company, you're a powerful athlete, I want you to do more things. And that's when I jumped into running the personal training division in the company and Group X, and was running Lifetime University at the time as well, our educational and division of the company. And it was a great experience, and never, you know, really never looked back. And then was able to progress over the years closer and closer into club operations, and started to understand club operations from my seat of running the personal training division and running Lifetime University. Did a lot of casting and succession planning for general managers. And then, you know, Brahm asked me to go run Chanhassen as a general manager for a period of time. And I originally felt like that was tremendously insulting for me, like all of us do early in our careers, because we think we've achieved so much. Mm-hmm. And that was too significant of a step back for my ego at the time. But I look back at it now, Jay, and, you know, it's obviously one of the most important things I did. As we talk about in the world that we live in today, those points that have been the most difficult and, you know, requiring us to persevere and really dig deep and have grit were the ones that defined us the most and created the most success for us.
Yeah. And that, I think that it's so often, I talk about this with previous guests too, and especially with people that maybe come from outside of Lifetime and then come into Lifetime, it, you know, if they get caught up in the title and they get caught up in things like that, it ruins the career. And if you can just take a step back and understand how our business is uniquely different and more complex in that they have more divisions and more departments and more direct reports than a typical GM or even a department PT manager or any of them in the other locations. It's just let that go and come back and learn it, and then you skyrocket.
Yeah, you think about where we've been. You know, when I was running PT, you know, you were one of the regionals at that time, I believe, and one of the superstars coming out of Burr Ridge and doing, you know, tremendous numbers and breaking records because of your deep knowledge of the business and the people that were involved with it, you know. And we were creating the future leadership in the company that went on to become ADs and, you know, senior area directors and obviously GMs throughout the company at that time. And, you know, but I still think the best is yet to come, as we'll talk about.
Absolutely. So when was it that the idea of going from where you were into the seat of COO, what was that conversation or process?
I don't think it was ever a plan, you know, for Brahm Akradi, you know, our founder and CEO at the time, or myself. I think it just was one of those things, as you just referenced, you do the right thing, and the rest takes care of itself. Yep. If you really can allow yourself to, you know, continue to just focus on how you create the opportunities and control your own destiny, and become the best at what you can be, the rest of the things I think can ultimately fall into place. And that's what I've been blessed and fortunate enough. And I just give tremendous gratitude for all the opportunities that I've, you know, been able to have here coming from that seat within Lifetime University in the fitness division, and then moving in to a chief operating officer and being in this role for many, many years now. It's been phenomenal. And I'm really fortunate, even though what we're all going through in the current we worked so hard for so little.
I can imagine. Yeah. And you know, one last thing I want to say, and then we can move on to another question is, you know, it sounds like it happened to you with the same thing that happened to me, is when I forgot the title and I got embedded and remember, you and Bram have always said this, is what do you love? And sometimes we don't take enough time to really process what it is truly that we love. And then we're blinded by what we're supposed to do versus what we truly love. And, you know, when you find that thing and you forget about the titles and you just go do that thing that you love, that's when the doors open. And, you know, it's happened to me as well. And thank you again.
I mean, we got a social system and a society that, you know, we know kind of measures and evaluates us based on certain things like titles and income and things like that. And you know, in the whole reality, it does come back. And that's one of the silver linings of this whole pandemic has been, that we can talk about some, is, you know, really is allows people to get back to the core values and their true north and think about what the hell's really important to them and what drives them right now. And that's been one of the really great things for me right now, in all honesty, you know, because it goes back down to really what matters in life.
Yeah.
And I think that's what you're really referencing.
Yeah. And, you know, I want to get into the vision, but you mentioned, and I think this one's perfect time to really dive into, like, what was your first response when this COVID thing hit and we're like, we got to shut it down? I mean, I can't even imagine. Walk us through some of that. I mean,
It's a great question, because, you know, it was mid-February. I know we had a bunch of our leaders out in Arizona for a large field leadership summit. And I distinctly remember projecting a slide up with the coronavirus on it, and, you know, kind of haphazardly and you know, distantly kind of referencing this issue coming on the horizon. But I was in denial. I mean, I was in flat out denial initially. And even as we came into March, I felt like it, and we had the first incidents in around the Mount Laurel, Philadelphia market. And we were told that, you know, would make sense given the safety of our team members to shut that club down. I really thought it was a 2 to 3 month impact at most. And I, none of us thought that would, you know, have the kind of magnitude of duration and financial and employee world impact that it's had. I was on calls early on with a group called Pure Gym over in, own clubs in Hong Kong, and of course they were impacted earlier. And they were taking measures, you know, that were beyond my imagination relative to scheduling visits, masks, you know, making every other piece of equipment obsolete, the things that we know are standard protocol today, but completely discounted. You know, I was starting to work on the COVID operating playbook, you know, in March, and brought first drafts of it into Brahm, and he completely threw me out of his office, as you might imagine, because we just couldn't get our head around the realities that would impose. and the impact that would have on our business, let alone any, you know, retailer or airline industry or cruise line industry. In the unfortunate reality is the way, you know, Jason, that government agencies have associated gyms with bars and restaurants, and yet it's just completely so different for a lot of reasons. We're obviously tracking all of our swipes. We can contact trace all of our members. We have highly different protocols than they're deploying. And you know, obviously people need health.
Yeah.
And they need health now more than ever to improve their immunity. And we've got to be able to serve those customers. Yeah. But that's really what happened. And it evolved from there. And, you know, the isolation, I never missed a day in the office here with a couple of our core teams. And we dug in, and we never worked like that in all my years, my 35 years of employment. And took no paycheck since the shutdown. So it's been challenging on multiple fronts.
Yeah. Well, and you know, something I didn't even know, I think that is amazing too, is, you know, connecting with clubs in China where they've dealt with it or dealing with it, and, you know, the playbook that you created. And from my understanding is that playbook is also being used not only for how we run business, but I think that it's also being looked at as kind of a gold standard across the industry as well. Correct.
But you know, it was started as a 400 page COVID protocol, and it has become heralded by health inspectors as, you know, the gold standard. And we've been proudly be able to use it in every market. And, you know, I feel like it has provided the context of keeping our team members, most importantly, safe, because we knew that was the number one thing. When we first club to open up was Oklahoma City, and the most important thing was making sure. And at that time, I didn't have these, you know, the little things like the thermal scanners for temperature checks for members. I was doing all temperature checks for team members, but I thought about it and paused. I said, why wouldn't I make sure that every member has no potential effects? And, you know, even now we've had to shut down two clubs in Canada again, because of outbreaks. And, you know, I'm aggressively looking at, you know, rapid testing right now, and the potential even for every member to be tested weekly as a standard protocol. So with these breathalyzers and saliva tests and other, you know, tests that are coming forward, I know we're going to continue to gain more technology there, and it's changing every day. But as you said, Jason, you know, it was social distancing, it was masks, it was about temperature checks, then it became our MERV 13 filters to create the right filtration and air quality control. So we continued to evolve that thing day in and day out, week in and week out, to make sure that it became the gold standard and the best in class.
Yeah. And that's kind of, you know, my other question was going to be, what are some of the things we did? You just rattled off, you know, many, and that's not all, obviously. And, you know, the ability to, you know, allow for, you know, for the month, for the trainers to get paid additional percentages, the, you know, the things like locking the trainers in so that they knew that they couldn't go backwards, but if they performed even, you know, more, they could still go forward. And, you know, really understanding, you know, what it's about, and, you know, not only paying and keeping people on furlough and paying their, you know, there's just so much that is, you know, to be grateful for working for us through all this.
Those were hard decisions. 40,000 team members going on furlough during that time. It was the most difficult part. Obviously, we tried hard to, you know, stay in contact with our team members, but that can be a challenge too with labor laws. But I agree with you. You know, I've found one of the silver linings of this process that I think it's important that our, you know, great team members understand, that, you know, that fine line of leadership now between our historical drive for achievement and BHAG, our big, hairy, audacious goals, and our passion for being the best, and accountability and our courage. But now that being anchored along with this deep sense of care and empathy like never before, and this compassion, I think that becomes more, I come more proud and overwhelmed with the vulnerability that I have now as a leader in maturation that I've never had. And I probably would never find through this pandemic, and the patience that I've been able to create. I mean, you've never known me for patience, Jason. but, you know, I think in today's world that we've gone through as a country and a world, you know, the most challenging moments of history. And I think it makes us listen with open ears and an open heart differently, you know. And that was, I knew that that investment in September for that initiative was a $400,000 or $500,000 investment for us, and a roll of the dice that I didn't know whether we would get the return back or not. But I felt like it was the right thing to do for our team, because I understood how difficult it was with so many of our members. We had 240,000 members now on hold that are sitting on the sidelines, just kind of waiting. They're confident in the Lifetime brand. They trust the Lifetime brand. Mm-hmm. It's been known for the highest quality through the 28 years we've been in business.
For sure.
And our phenomenal team members. But, you know, business is different in Ardmore and Philadelphia with, the COVID protocols and the COVID narrative than it is in San Antonio, Texas.
Yeah.
And it's extremely difficult, extremely different. Yeah. But I do think, when you think about what's happened in the world with global health, economic health, racism, political unrest, it allows us now to focus on the things that matter more than ever. Yeah. Our people, our team, you know, the people that are going to be able to make this thing. And we look at this situation much, unfortunately, like a prairie fire. I think it's a great analogy. Unfortunately, prairie fire burns a lot of things, burns beautiful looking plants and trees. It burns the bad looking things. And unfortunately, that's what this epidemic and the closures of the health club industries and boutiques of studios has created. What will come up out of this is the beautiful flowers, unlike ever before. And we know that many operators are not going to be able to persevere through this thing, unfortunately. And it will create a lot of consolidation and a lot of opportunities for folks that come out the other end. And my point being, as you know, Jason, one of the first things we had to go, like every company, is cash flow preservation. Yep. So what are we going to do with rent? How are we going to make sure we're managing the day-to-day, week-to-week, month-to-month cash flow? Because we went from making $50 million of EBIT a month to losing $30 or $40 million of EBIT a month.
Wow.
You know, in July, August, we got to break even EBITDA, earnings before interest, tax, depreciation, amortization, or profitability. And, you know, we're gradually earning back. October would have been our bottom, and we're starting to build up membership balance in most clubs now. And, we're abundantly optimistic about the future.
Yeah, and I'm seeing it too, and just talking with the trainers and the amount of, you know, people. Obviously, we've lost some, and we're gaining some new ones, and the ones that have stayed with us, just the appreciation for things that we're doing, giving back in education and the things that you guys have been able to do, and just offering, you know, a place for them to do what they love has been fantastic. So, and, you know, I think, you know, I love the, you know, our new kind of three buckets of live, train, and eat, and, you know, that live bucket expanding to, like you had said, you know, how our industry has changed from being kind of bodybuilder meatheads in the back, you know, back in the day to, you know, hey, it's about behavior change. It's about mindfulness. It's about sleep. It's about just getting out and moving. It's not just the training. And then there's the training and the eat, and you put that thing together. And I always say that that's what brings about the well-being and the health and happiness, which is our, you know, kind of our tagline. So, man, that's great. You know, you started to talk a little bit about you know, the vision and kind of what the company and trainers can expect. Would you be able to go a little bit deeper on that and kind of things that you guys have been working on, you know, to move forward into, you know, the fourth quarter and then into the new year?
I'd love to, and I'm proud to. As I said, I think it starts from the foundation that we've worked maniacally on for the 28 years is the brand trust, you know, and be able to go back as the respected, highest quality, best experience brand. You know, and I think that's why members and our team members have been open to coming back into our environment, because they know we're going to be the best game in town. I do believe that, you know, our members and team members crave community, they crave experiences, and they will again. Certainly, you know, Peloton and Nordic Track and Tonal and other brands have struck the right time. We know that one, we do need to have an omni-channel presence, and we're working diligently on what that will look like. Yeah. And I will stand up the ability to meet the consumer wherever they are, at home or at the club or on the road somewhere. But I think, you know, as a company, we had a net promoter score coming to COVID of 50. And that's, you know, in the same class of, you know, world-class brands that we all know and love. Yeah. And so we have a great foundation to go build upon. Now, what I think this has provided us again, the opportunity to do the silver lining, making, you know, lemonade out of lemons, is gets back to what the most important things are, the core focus. And you know, obviously we're focused on the clubs, which, you know, has gotten the business there and allowed us to be able to venture into the living and the work venues. We're obviously slowing and pausing the growth of a lot of those other new verticals that we've been had explosive growth in. We are adding new clubs. You know, we'll open a club in Manhattan here, 23rd Street awesome. Club in the November timeframe. We'll open the new club in Happy Valley, you know, where you and your family reside now, in Peoria, later this year. So awesome. We'll continue to, and then we'll add 6 or 8 new clubs next year. And as you know, Jason, we've got to start the construction up on those clubs to make sure they come through, because they're long gestation periods.
Yeah.
But it's all about being really thoughtful about cash flow. You know, we made a lot of tough decisions here at the corporate office on reducing the headcount and making sure we keep the players that are the most impactful. And, you know, we had to make a lot of tough decisions here. But we're back on, you know, making sure the in-center businesses can be cash flow positive. Our main focus for the business is membership balance growth, as I talked about, week over week, month over month, dues growth, and how more of all of our business units contribute to making sure that that is part of what we do, because as we all know, that's what will help create the flywheel for profitability growth and allow us to get back into the kind of flow that we need to. Our investors are extremely confident and supportive of our business. You know, they've TPG and Leonard Green are our primary investor partners, and we've got a board meeting this Friday, and they're tremendously supportive. They know that we've taken all the measures that we need to. They've got a extremely strong investment portfolio, and they will continue to support the company through the difficult times. There's no doubt about it. So our team members can be very confident that our brand will be one that will successfully persevere, but also thrive on the back end of this ultimately.
Yes,
it has been and will be a difficult time. But when we come through the other end, and it's probably going to be the time that therapeutics become mass and vaccines and so forth, probably the spring or so of 2021, mm-hmm. we think pool season will be one of the most epic times that we'll see. It's important to note that our new membership joins in October, Jason, are about 104 to 105% year over year last year.
Oh, man. So, I didn't know that.
Again, it just gives you an idea of the strength of the brand and the strength of the business right now.
Yep.
So we've got more new joins. Now they're a little different.
Yeah.
They're skewed more younger, more single, than family and elderly, of course, yeah. because of concerns of underlying yeah. immunity and things that we're all aware with in the COVID world. But now more than ever, Jason, what we do within the training division becomes key to the point you talked about earlier. Yeah. Being a holistic trainer, thinking about rest, thinking about nutrition and supplementation, that an old trainer that, you know, yeah. in our early days just wasn't well, you know, versed in.
No.
And we've been asking our trainer for years to continue to transform themselves and broaden themselves and make them, you know, more educated on all elements of being that holistic trainer. And now's the time when that's becoming more critical than ever.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the messages that I heard loud and clear, you know, on the calls that I've been on also that I think people need to know is this concept of taking our trainers, which obviously our staff size are smaller now than they've ever been, and making that smaller staff size as productive as possible. So not only are they enjoying their job and their career in it, but they're making potentially more money now because there's a smaller staff. And then as we bring people on, we're looking at it from that perspective as well, you know, as, you know, slowly growing back, which yeah. I think is fantastic. And people need to hear that loud and clear.
Yeah. I think that Navy SEAL team of the best of the best. I mean, obviously first off, there's some pride in that.
Yeah.
You know, that I'm one of the few back in here doing this deal, but it is the opportunity for people not to just, you know, reset in the world, but reset their lives. And, you know, how do they think about what they can do better? You know, I think when we talk about training, you and I've always talked about the fundamentals of program design and, you know, exercise prescription. We've talked about how to deal with that client program and that progression and the excellence in that now is so much more important than ever because, hey, we got to figure out how we're retaining that client long-term and creating more value with that client. So the little things matter more than ever. I think the little cues and the motivation and the engagement, whether they're in the club or not in the club, you know, and what's really going to be important for this omni-channel thing that I was talking about before is, and I know we've been testing some of this virtual training yeah. and my wife, Ellen, is doing the video training at home yeah. With one of our trainers and she loves it. Yeah. But there's going to be more and more opportunities for the trainers to have more impact. Yeah.
And you know, I've said it, you know, several times on the podcast, and I think it's important to say again is, you know, again, we were bodybuilders and then, you know, it was told not to talk about nutrition back originally in the certifications. And then that changed obviously dramatically. And yes, we can and should be talking nutrition within the boundaries. And then it got corrective exercise and more physical therapy stuff. And now it's the behavioral side and it's the sleep and the lab testing and, you know, all of that stuff and really virtual. And, you know, at the end of the day, if you're not evolving, you're going to get left behind. And the virtual coaching from an accountability standpoint, from a reaching more people standpoint and, you know, keeping your business in check so you can have a consistent paycheck. Those are skills that we all need to develop because it's going to change. It's going to continue on, you know, changing into the future. So I always say continue your education is always the key to this and then applying that
stuff. Part of the things that we talked about with my own career, your career is how we continue to reinvent ourselves at each of those various inflection points, some of it forced upon us, some of it, you know, we got to go create and, you know, we can't control a pandemic, but we can control our own behavior and how we respond to it. And that's what I would encourage a lot of our team members to think about is how are they going to challenge themselves to continue to grow and be the absolute best that they can be at their trade. And I know from that, the doors will just open for themselves, whether that be progression within, you know, the personal training world at Lifetime or progression in other ways at Lifetime.
Yeah.
And those are going to be really bountiful.
Yeah. And, you know, I'm excited. I'm going to be doing this future podcast where I really want to break it down for trainers because so many people, they think that, you know, the grass is greener outside. And I'm not saying that, you know, if you start your own thing and you can do it, God bless you. And that's great. But you know, when companies take 40, 50, whatever the percentage is, 30%, you're not understanding what that 30 and 40% is. And if you go and off on your own, what's your rent? You know, what's your equipment cost? What's your gas cost? What, you know, what's your health insurance cost? There's no retirement fund. Like, you gotta literally outline all of those things to see, okay, now am I really giving away 40%, you know? And yeah, it's just, some people don't see it that way. Yeah, so
let alone the 100-hour work weeks, right?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. So, you know, I can't tell you again how extremely proud I am. And, you know, obviously, you know, I had my short little stint away, and it helped me grow just dramatically, not only personally through getting beat down a little bit, but also to the love for the brand. And, you know, I am super excited for the future. I know we're going to be the last man standing, but anything you have parting ways, you know, that you want to share with the team and even trainers and people in the industry.
Yeah, I appreciate it. I think, I do believe that one of the most valued characteristics for us is the humility, no matter where we're at. You know, we've always been anchored on the principle of the golden rule. And one of the things that I use most and why I try to do interviews outside of the office is to see how they treat the waiter or the waitress or the, you know, someone that they may not need. So, you know, treat people the way you'd want to be treated and show respect. I think we are looking for an environment at Lifetime that's one of belonging now. And I do think that the diversity of Lifetime will continue to build in gender and race and a lot of different ways. I do have tremendous optimism and gratitude. And I think those things provide us with a flywheel that just keeps turning this thing. My recommendation would be just continue to look at how we can control what we can control, and that becomes our own behavior. A lot of the elements, hopefully we start to see the light at the end of the tunnel. I know hope is not a good strategy, but in times like this, it's the thing that we do need to anchor on. And it is the best strategy that we can provide. And I mean, our trainers need to understand that from my own journey, your journey, other leaders here, we have such a deep, relentless passion for their trade, and the skill and the capability that they provide. Without them, the experience of Lifetime would be relatively meaningless. And we do desire for our trainers to make this a lifelong career pursuit for them. We do desire for them to make significant money, so that they can provide for their families and their kids, and create, you know, wealth for them. And we want to create a platform for them to be able to do that. And that excites us every day because it is a phenomenal partnership that they deliver for us. I mean, I read the testimonials from our members every day about the impact that our trainers have on their lives. And I got to say, this is the reason I know you and I got in this business, Jay, was changing lives. And there's nothing more fulfilling than that, mm-hmm, and rewarding than that. And I know that's why most of our trainers do what they do. And we see that and we value that. And that gratitude runs deep in us. And that will keep coming back to doing things to make sure that our trainers, that Lifetime is the best place to work for them. Yep. That will continue to be our rally cry, that we will continue to provide substantive basis for as we go forward.
Yeah, and to, one thing I got to add to that is, you know, again, being away and also just, you know, we're always looking at what other people are doing. I've always said this, there's no other organization that I've seen that has the robust infrastructure within fitness that allows trainers to move into a role staying within fitness. Because some, again, I've been the guy that really never really wanted to go GM to stay in fitness and find a place for me. And it's not even on the same planet. I mean, obviously I work for Lifetime, so I'm a little biased, but I've seen what's out there and nobody has the infrastructure that we have. And I think you and the executive team and Brom for, you know, throughout the years, not wavering on that and not stripping that down.
Yeah. I mean, I've always been so proud of what our trainers have been able to do and what they've brought to build this world-class brand at Lifetime. It's not Brom, it's not myself, it's our team and the trainers that are really the result of that, those impressions and that impact. And I've always said as well, Jason, as you know, I'm very proud of the top line revenue growth. I've never felt like, I've always felt the most important thing for us is to pay our trainers at the best rate of anybody in the industry, to recruit the best in class trainers and retain them. And so as a result, I've never been focused on what that margin rate of a personal training business is. There's other ways we'll improve the efficiencies of our training business. It's never going to be in our margin rate for that our trainers get compensated. And I'm proud of us always making sure that we don't have the best margins, even with the low end health club providers. So I just want to make sure our trainers know that this is a place for them and that they'll be able to thrive here and they'll be able to grow here, both personally and professionally.
Man, that's awesome. And I can't thank you enough. I guess my one quick last question is, you know, I think internally the trainers want to know who won the last bike race between you and Brom.
Great question. Great question. I can tell you that we just rode a couple Saturdays ago here to do a business meeting, and Brom wasn't as in good a shape as he normally is. So he asked me to slow down a couple times because it was in the recovery heart rate. But Brom has beat me in the last Leadvilles. I have to concede that. He's been better trained for altitude of 13,000. And so he's beat me in the Leadville race. But normally around here, I can flatland. I can still beat the guy.
Love it. Love it.
But it's always serious competition.
Oh, for sure. I was way back when I tried to attempt, so I can't say anything.
Well, we still talk about our times out at Bloomington Ferry.
Yes. Well, Jeff, I can't thank you enough. And trainers out there and just anyone, you know, to have our COO on and spend an hour during probably one of the craziest times is just goes to show you where the level of focus and care is with the company. So I can't thank you enough and really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Jason. I appreciate being on.
Thanks, man. Have a great day.
All right. Bye-bye.